different organizational dynamics, and that makes a difference.
Perfect. Okay, that works.
Shelby, next slide.
Is that working?
No. I can do that.
Is the...
Oh, hey!
Oh, well. That was him. All right, let me have another slide here, please. All right, so service before self, this is for the Army, you can pick your service, but this is I'm going to do this, I'm going to serve people, I'm going to live these values. I don't quit, I don't leave anybody behind. And on the civilian side, it's like, yeah, I'm signing up to do this, what's in it for me? What are you going to do for me? And that's not how you went to work.
How many of you, the service was your first real job?
Right? So if that's the case, then that's how you go kind of eyes into every job. Kind of an all-in attitude. That's not generally the way the rest of the world works. Still doesn't work. Next slide, please. All right, so you talked about, taking the self out of this. You got a basic training. There's a lot of things that are no's in basic training, right? No matter what service you go to, what branch. They take away your stuff, they take away your hair. When I went in the mid-80s, there were still a lot of people with fairly long hair. I was at a reception station for a week. We're all in civilian clothes. We're all living in this open barracks. We're all learning how to poop next to each other with no stalls, because that's one of the things they took away. The guys will take away all shame from you, because you just don't get to deal with that. And then they drug us all out one day, threw us on a bus, took us in, put us in green suits with no name tags, and cut all our hair off. And we all stood around outside looking at each other. We got to know each other for a week, and none of us knew who anybody was anymore, because we all looked just alike. We had tall people and short people and fat people and skinny people. That was it. On the civilian side, this is team building for the military. And it is team building, right? You still remember people from your basic training. Mostly your drill sergeants. But you still remember some of the people you went through. I remember the guy that stole a deuce and a half and tried to leave. It didn't work out well. No, he didn't he stole a deuce and a half and an M16.
Ooh.
And I mean, if you're going to pick a getaway car, seriously, that is a bad choice. That is a bad choice. But on the civilian side, we're going to teach you, when we do team building, we do things where we hold hands and help each other cross bridges. And we do that in the military. It's different. We do mousetrap car races. We volunteer for things. We go to trampoline parks. Laser tag. We played laser tag, kind of. Kind of. All right. Next slide, please.
Dysfunctional.
Yeah. Yeah. Mobility. Most branches of the service, most times, especially at a time when we're doing a lot of deployments, your time and your place is not your own. Right? You don't get to necessarily pick your next assignment all the time. Sometimes you can. But it's always going to depend on the needs of the service. You're going to leave when you're going to leave. You're going to come back when you're going to come back. And there's not generally a lot of... I understand they're nice about things now. About family things and keeping things together. And children, but I think that depends on where... It's still going to depend on the needs of the service. On the civilian side of things, mobility is encouraged. Sometimes it's a ladder to help you move up in a company. If you work for a big company, if you work for a big oil company, you have to do a deployment. You have to do an expat time somewhere. But that can be Canada. So, that's different than most of our deployments. If you don't want to play in the Army and do that, you generally have to leave or do something else, and there's sometimes stigma attached with that. So it's just... It's different. Mobility is different. Everything's different. We have the next slide, please. Rules of engagement. It just means how do we get things done? And you guys have probably all experienced this. You're trained, we drop a plan, we get orders, we do things. If we don't think it's right, we can talk about it after we're done, right? We'll do an after action, we'll sit down and talk about the process. And it doesn't matter whether you're deployed somewhere or whether you're doing paperwork in an office. You do it how you're trained to do it, and if you have a better idea, you'll talk about it, and maybe you'll get somebody to listen to you, and maybe you'll get somebody to approve the process. But processes change very slow in large bureaucracies, and there is the very definition of a large bureaucracy is any military organization. It is a large bureaucracy. So we have different rules of how we do things. In some businesses, in your businesses, you may give employees the freedom to innovate, the freedom to move, freedom to make decisions on their own. That's not, for obvious reasons, something we clearly get to do. Now, the U.S. military is a little different than a lot of foreign militaries because we do teach people to think independently. Because we want people to act in the absence of leadership, right? When I was in the Dark Ages and the Russians were still the bad guys, they're still bad guys, right? One of their things as a CAV pilot, when we went out and practiced shooting things, you pick, when you're dealing with subject area stuff, you pick the vehicle with the best. Because if you took out command and control, you took out action. Because they wouldn't. U.S. military is not that way. You teach people to act independently in the absence of control. All right, next slide. Leadership. First thing they teach you is to be a follower, right? Everybody gets to learn to be a follower. Then you start teaching leadership at every level as people move up. That's the way it's supposed to work. You learned early to respect rank, respect position, not necessarily the person. Anybody ever have a commander or leader in the military that they didn't have a tremendous amount of respect for? We've all had that. Anybody ever seen that person because they were such a pain in the ass get promoted and moved up to something else? Yeah.
I see that in my job now.
Yeah.
I still think law enforcement promote the problem.
Makes me tired. All right, so immediate orders, we learned discipline. In the civilian world, I wouldn't say there is no discipline, but there's, you certainly get more of, I need you to go do this, and somebody looking at you and going, no, I don't want to do that.
It's not in my PD.
That's right. It's not, yeah, it's, yeah, there's, and especially in to like today, where we have an incredibly low unemployment rate. There's other things for people to do. It's that. Oh, yes. I'll do something. Okay. So this is probably the biggest area where people struggle in transition and how to manage that, how to learn to lead people by getting them to come along and do things and not just by position power. Right? If you have rank, you have position power. But position power has to be wielded very carefully. Because there's nothing behind it other than what's on your uniform, right? If they don't respect you, if they don't believe you're doing something right or taking them in the right direction, you get people to do what you say to do, but they're going to do it. They're not going to do it as well as they possibly could. Any thoughts here? Experiences? Positive, negative? How have you changed your leadership style since you left the service?
It's more touchy-feely now.
More touchy-feely. Explain that.
You have to, in most of us in leadership, was an absence of emotion, connectness with anybody in the military. But as soon as I transitioned into the civilian side and hiring people, like you have to pay attention to their feelings, at which point you're like, well, what's that? But actually be in tune to how that will make them feel so that they don't blow up or leave.
Right. I mean, we have carrots and sticks. In the military, you had big sticks, right? You had big sticks, but you really didn't have a lot of carrots. It's not like I can give you a bonus if you do this, or I'm going to give you extra time off, or I'm going to do this. You don't have that. That's the expectation. The expectation is you're going to do your damn job, right? Hang on just a second, both of you. You had something to say?
Yeah, I think one of the things I had to do was cussing. Well, honestly, in the military, you couldn't get anything done if you weren't cussing someone. You know, it was a sign of leadership, and now, you know, you got to tone it down a little bit.
Yeah, I joke about it. I have my Army vocabulary, and I have my other vocabulary. Occasionally, it leaks out, but not. I try to keep it in check.
Yeah. First, I had a quick person in church. And now the rest.
Yeah. Okay.
I prayed a lot for you.
All right. What was it you had?
I think you have to develop that power of influence, because not only, you know, when you're interacting on the civilian side, you may be interacting with organizations outside your own as well.
Absolutely.
And so it's, you have a responsibility, but may not have the authority. So you have to develop that power of influence, and networking relationships become huge.
Yeah, if anybody's ever worked as a project manager, that's the typical project manager position is you have all the responsibility and none of the authority. So you have to learn to influence what's happening around you. And with your employees, it becomes a lot easier to work on the, not even necessarily the carrot side, but the positive reinforcement side. Reinforce the things that are happening right and get more of them. Right? If you're constantly correcting, it tends to drive negative behavior. So you have to be really careful. Yes, sir. Which one? What are you going to?
So my transition was having more of a participatory leadership style, allowing your team to participate as well, utilizing a pull approach versus a push approach, telling everyone what to do, because you find out some smart people in the room as well. You're just the one that's the leader and assigned as the leader.
Absolutely.
But as you listen, you say, wow, some pretty smart people in the room.
It's not easy for everybody to listen, though, is it? Right? But there are. The other thing you have to do at some point is take responsibility. You hired these people.
Not all the time, but yeah.
Right? Not all the time, but this is your, you guys are all here because you're starting something. Whether you're doing that now or not, at some point, you're going to hire people. And those, so, A, be careful about who you hire. That's a whole different conversation.
Only hire veterans.
Only hire what?
Veterans.
Only hire veterans?
Yeah.
Well,
that has some problems too.
That has some problems. That carries its own issues, for sure. But also, you know, it depends exactly. I mean, if you're not building bridges, writing code, or doing things that require very specific technical skills, I will always try to hire attitude and aptitude before. I can train somebody to do almost anything.
Right.
But if they come in with the right attitude, they come in with a bad attitude, you're not going to fix that.
I would say that one of the things that I notice is that you don't have rank on your sleeve. So I've seen situations where somebody walk into a room and they're just carrying on with a military attitude, and the person next to them is actually the person that's going to be their boss or somebody they're trying to work a contract with, and they completely burn a bridge. Don't even realize it, because you're not in a situation where you know that colonel's standing next to you anymore. So,
no, and you don't know. And it's become even harder in the last 30 years, because 1985, you could look at somebody and tell by how they dressed where they fit in the organization. It was very clear. It was almost very military. Now, if you're working in any kind of company, there's very few. I mean, you're clearly the exception to the rule back here. Shirt guy.
Every day.
Hey, I just said that was a compliment. I just said he was exceptional.
It's always nice
of you. He didn't turn red.
I'm not being charged anything.
But according to the way you're dressed, you've got stars on your shoulders. But today you don't know, right? You can walk into a company and you could walk into a billion-dollar tech company, and the dude over in the corner with messy hair that looks like he just woke up and has on a t-shirt and jeans owns 80% of the stock.
Steve Jobs always wore a black turtleneck, jeans, and tennis shoes.
Yeah, so it was like the military. He had a uniform. He had a uniform. He wore it every day. You know? So one of the things I miss the most, I had one big zipper to put on and black boots. That's it. You know, and every day it's like, what am I going to wear? Green. That sounds good. They changed, when I was at Fort Campbell, they changed it to where we had a commanding general for a while that didn't like pilots, and he didn't want to wear flight suits, so he said if you're not on the schedule to fly, you have to wear BDUs or whatever the uniform of the day was. And so naturally we scheduled all shifts to fly every day. It's like, no, I'm on the flight schedule today. Oh, I can't fly today. Anyway. Trying to kick pilots to follow rules. That's funny. All right. Any other comments about this? Right. Leadership style is very different. How do you lead that's different now than you did when you were? Or how do you plan to lead differently?
When you're in, you get them to focus on the mission. When you're out, you get them to understand how the mission will help them.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah, that's good.
It's more, it's much, much more focus on things like employee development, personal development, professional development, and you know, this is why I need you to do that. Instead of go do it, and then when you come back, I'll tell you why you have to do that.
Wait.
Right.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I was right. In the Air Force.
Yeah. Okay.
So,
yeah.
So, but the other thing about personal development, we get frustrated when our own employees want to take time to learn and develop new skills and do things. Because you've got them in a place and you just need, I got crap I need you to do today, right? But the thing is, you've got to train your people. You've got to train some. You've got to be training somebody to replace you, right? You're not going to grow. You're not going to scale up unless you can build a pipeline of people that are replacing each other as they move. When I came into this position, there was another girl in Chad's position, and Chad was in a position down where he is, and she self-selected out, fine with me. And I moved him up, now I've got to replace his position, and I'm already thinking about what he's going to end up doing next, because he's not going to be here forever. Now, and my job as a leader is to make sure he's prepared to go to the next step. So in order to do that, though, I've got to hire somebody in the position that's going to work for him that can be trained to do everything he's doing so I can have an orderly progression through there and I'm not left trying to do everything one day, right? You have to look after your people because that makes your workplace a good workplace and people will actually stick longer and you'll have less turnover. And turnover is horribly expensive. Yes.
So probably the biggest thing that I learned is in the military, it's like, hey, you're a gunner, you're a driver, you're this, you're that. And it is what it is regardless of what your skill set is, regardless of what your capability is. I'm just going to PT the hell out of you until you get it right.
Yeah.
And now it's very different. It kind of goes back to that HBDI stuff that we did. Like when I was putting my board of director together, trying to find the right people for the right areas that I needed.
Right.
And that was probably the most difficult transition.
Yeah. Yeah. And boards are a little special too. That's a different thing. But you're absolutely
sure,
right. And you have, everybody has roles. But even in the military, if you had a role, you still were expected to do other things. Right? You're expected to do what needs to be done.
Professional duties.
Yeah. You don't get to say, yeah, this is not, when I first started this role, I went to one of our tenured professors. And we were putting together a program to support one of their classes. And I said, I need you and I to work together on this, because if we don't develop this together, then you're not going to be happy with it. And he looked at me, just serious, I'll get out, and said, I'm not incented to do that. That's not part of what I'm paid to do.
Well, I think that's another benefit that we have as veterans, because you know, in the military, you work two up, one down of your rank, whatever. So. I kind of that with everything that we do as well.
Yeah. I mean, we all, especially as the owner of a small business or a large business, you're going to do what you need to do.
Right?
If it's your turn to mop the floor, you're going to mop the floor because nobody else is there to mop the floor. If you need to make decisions, you get to do those too. And sometimes you get to do those things all at the same time.
Yeah, no. I mean, one of the things I've done, I think in my team, I have about 9 people who work for me. And everybody has read Extreme Ownership.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody has read Team of Teams. You know, so you start bringing some of that. You can also, there are some ways of bringing some of that military culture into your organization because they are, right now, they're, you know, some of the best you know, management books are actually written by former military.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, I think that you can also bring that in, and I think that, you know, when people understand where you're coming from, because they have a, you have already, you know, have these discussion groups with them, you have read the book together, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's not just, hey, you read this, you know, but it's more like, hey, every Friday we're going to have a meeting, we're going to spend 30 minutes reading, you know, talking about chapter 3 of Team of Teams, you know.
Right.
And then you start talking about silos, you start talking about this. And
see, when you're doing that, you're taking the time to invest in your people. They appreciate that, and they know that.
That's it. Okay. Sorry. No. So I mean, I think that in that regard, at least for me, it has made it a lot easier to tell people, hey, you know, we are all here, you know, all hands on deck, you know, if there are some things that we need to get through, you know, I think people are a lot more willing, if you're giving them challenging work, if you're, like you said, you're telling them, hey, well, where's your career progression? Where are you going? You know, are you going to be here for 2 years and then go to law school? Then let's talk about that. Let's talk about how we can support you, how we can get you to do things that are going to get you ready for law school, or going to get ready for whatever it is that you want to do. You know, let's talk about it.
And I think if you're growing your company, you have an even bigger challenge. You can say, look, I want us to be twice as big, and for us to do that, I need you to move 2 levels up. So I need you to work with me to help you learn the skills and whatever it is you need to do to move up, so you can grow with the company and you can do better. All right, let's next slide, please. You're really good at that. You're a tech guy, right?
Well, one of my very first jobs as an airman was to flip slides when we used overhead projectors. Just transition.
Were you an A-man in high school?
No.
I mean, you got an lithograph machine?
I was at headquarters and I had one stripe. So.
Oh, you talk about those
lithograph
mimeograph machines. Yeah. You say that and I can smell it.
Yeah.
I thanked him for my father. He was a teacher.
Yeah. Oh, man. You kids in here, you missed out. Whole generation stuff. All right. Communication standards. What was the first one you mentioned a while ago?
Had to stop cussing.
You had to stop cussing, yes. Communication standards. Yeah.
Go from the cuss sandwich to the compliment sandwich.
That's exactly right. Does anybody know what a compliment sandwich is?
You're great. You're great.
You're great. That's exactly right. But it makes giving corrective feedback more palatable. Instead of just saying you're an idiot.
Like, feces sandwich.
Yes, that's exactly right. You said that without swearing. And somehow that actually made it grosser. What's expected of me? Communicating what's expected. There, you have to be very clear about your expectations in your place. You really can't overstate that, right? You have to be very clear. You have processes the way you want your people to deal with customers, right? You can't just say, here's a piece of paper, read it, and go do that. You have to show them, right? You have to teach them, you have to show them, you have to set examples, how you want them to be. We don't have any underlying universal concepts for all of our employees like you have in the service, right? We all at least have some concept of what it means to serve and of honor and how you're supposed to do things. So we talked about explaining your mission logo. I think it is important that employees have a sense of mission. If you could, you all know the importance of having a mission. You have all experienced the transition from leaving an organization where you felt like you had a mission, whatever that was, when you went to work every day, to sometimes going to a place where you struggled to find that mission. And I would guess for most of us, having a sense of mission is very important. Without that sense of mission, it makes it hard to get up and go to work. Mm-hmm. And I know for me, I've had several intermediate jobs where I was like, why? Why am I doing this, right? It's technically a good job, it made good money, but I hated going to work because I didn't feel like I really had a purpose, right? Yes, sir.
I will do that purpose. Stepping into the emergency management profession, a lot of us are one person shops.
Right.
And so when I stepped into that position, I had to write my own motion. I mean, I figured out really quickly that I could literally sit there and show up every day and collect a paycheck and do nothing else and nobody would care.
But you need to have a vision.
But yeah, exactly. And so that just, once I came to realize that, I'm like, this is going to drive me crazy unless I do things and accomplish stuff because of my personality.
Right.
So.
Right. So everybody with the thing that they are starting or have, the business they're doing now, does everybody feel like they have a mission? I know you do. Right? Everybody feel like they have a mission? Good.
I want to touch on, I know the exact opposite of this, unfortunately. I'm talking about communication.
You were the Marine, right?
Yes.
Okay.
But talking about law enforcement, I'm looking. But yes. So our issue is because of the way it's established, they try to play paramilitary, but they don't have the mentality. They're not vets. They're whatever they were before. And so the information trickles down over time span. So the administration will have a conversation, make a decision. It'll get to the sergeants. It'll get to the shift supervisors. You get to us. By the time we get it, they've changed their minds. It's something different now.
I want you to remember this, what you're talking about right here, and save that for my session tomorrow. We're going to talk about vertical communication versus horizontal communications.
Yeah.
Remember me saying yesterday all this stuff blends together? This is one of those things. All right, so, just people understanding why they're there, why they're here to do what's, and they do have to understand what's in it for them. That's the bottom line. These are the bottom line. Nobody that doesn't wear a uniform comes to work out of a sense of duty, right? They may have some duty to it, but they are not generally contractually obligated with the threat of Leavenworth for coming to work.
Yeah, the duty is got to pay the mortgage. I don't care how I do it.
Yeah. That's exactly right. That's exactly right. But that's it. Okay. Questions about that? Any comments, statements? Yeah. Next slide, please.
Bottom line up front.
Yeah.
That can cause problems. Don't ever do this to your wife and say, okay, come on, get to the point. Not a good idea.
That explains it.
Is there any?
Yeah, that's why she's in charge.
The other side of that is the sarcastic yes, dear. It doesn't work either.
Pelosi clap.
Yeah. All right. So suggestions: when you have issues with these things, when you're trying to cross these hurdles at work, or you have a problem you want to deal with, talk with your friends. You guys, we've all been in different places. We've all been down different parts of this road together. So you know somebody who's probably dealt with this before. Join a veterans group. Again, this is really for. This is geared towards somebody who's been out like a year or less. So. You guys, some of you are the old guys at the beginning, so welcome. Have some veterans on your team, but don't overdo it or underdo it, right? You want to have a mix?
No, I
don't. Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do. Because you got to find, like in your business, when I ran a software development team for a while, and I would hire. Biggest problem with software developers is some of them are incredibly productive and good, and some of them are just okay. They're good, but they're not good. So part of the interview process is always, what are you working on for fun at home? And if they go, I just write code at work, I don't do anything at home, it's like, okay, you go in this one. And somebody said, I'm working on this really cool thing that's gonna change the world or a game or whatever. It didn't matter what they were working on. They were writing code all day and then going home and writing code. Because by doing that, they were getting better every night. If they went home and did that, they came in with ideas on how to make our stuff better. So, but you needed a mix of those people, right? You need a mix. When I worked for an engineering company, I would have guys that had been an engineer for 30 years, and you take a problem to them, I got this thorny problem, I need you to solve this, and they look at it and go, oh yeah, when I was at Grumman, we tried that 15 years ago, and you can't do that. And then I'm walking down the hall, and a 22-year-old that just graduated from school, and I say, can you solve this problem? If not, let me look at it. And come back the next day and go, oh, yeah, I figured it out. Because they didn't know they couldn't do it, right? But you need both of those. you need that institutional wisdom, you need that knowledge of things that have been done, and you also need somebody that's not smart enough to know what they can't do. Yes, sir.
Yeah, just about that on the hire veterans. I mean, I something really interesting happened to me. I think it will be good to share. You know, I had this. I do some work with ABCMR, the Army Board for Correction of Military Records, and I get this Marine, very square away guy, and he, you know, I'm helping him with some of his stuff, and I'm like, man, this guy would be awesome, you know, to have as an employee, because he's just so task oriented. Everything you told him to do, he would bring. He was like, wow, you know. And you know, sometimes you get this idea, you know, hey, I'm gonna try to hire this person because I'm gonna feel more comfortable, you know, this person knows my culture. You gotta also remember, I mean, first of all, I mean, not everybody's caught up to do what you're doing. And just because, you know, that person's looking for a job without more, and I said, oh, you know, let's just hire this guy. He lasted 3 days and he was always very nice. I mean, I didn't fire him, he just came and said, this is not for me. When you're trying to make those decisions, don't let that, yes, yeah, we are part of a brotherhood, a sisterhood, you know, and but we also got to understand everybody has their priorities, everybody has their dream. He wanted to work in a range, and even when he had, you know, all the tools to succeed, you know, at almost any job, that's what he wanted to do. He wanted to be outside, he wanted to be shooting guns, you know, and that's what it is. So, I mean, you gotta see that, and you gotta say, hey, just don't let that, you know, cloud your judgment, even if you feel a lot of connection and empathy with people, because you're not doing them a favor. You're actually maybe putting them in a position that is very difficult for them to say no, you know, and then things don't work out.
That's a good point. And don't try to shove a square peg in a round hole. Like, I really want you to work for me. I really think you'd be good at this. If it's not working, it's not working. Right?
Along those same lines, nobody's going to work at the same pace in your business as you do.
Absolutely.
So don't levy that expectation on somebody. They may be great, they may be awesome, they may be this, but nobody is ever going to be as invested as you are. And you just got to remember that, because sometimes it gets, we'll call it discouraging. You know, because like, oh, come on guys, right? We need 5 more minutes and we can push through this and we'll be done. No, man, I'm done for the day. I'm cooked. And you just got to accept the fact that you're going to have people who just don't have the same pace as you do.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. All right. Always remember 99.5%. I don't know that percent is exactly accurate, but a large number of people have not shared your experiences. And all they know about military service is what they've seen on TV or in a movie. And we all know that's an exact representation.
I'm in trouble.
I'll speak to that, because just recently, less than 2 months ago, there was a news piece about recent high school graduates. Because of what the news cycle has been over the past decade, recent high school graduates believe that the majority of veterans have PTSD. Majority of veterans, not majority of combat veterans, not majority of theater veterans, not majority of infantry, majority of veterans, period.
Right.
Don't
ask them to define what they believe PTSD is, because that's a whole different.
Yeah, it is a whole broad spectrum.
Yeah, because they believe that means you're going to shut somebody up in a house and shoot your family. That's when they think PTSD. They're thinking
right.
The worst of the worst.
Because the news cycles have driven a misconception not only of what PTSD is, but of what being a veteran.
Yeah, they did a survey and said students are afraid to be in class with veterans, and that's why, because of the conception that the media is putting out.
So that's part of our job now is to change it.
Yes,
absolutely. 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 Yeah. Dude, it's funny you say news cycle. It's not a news cycle.
Yeah.
Right? As soon as we went to 24-hour news channels, we created this beast that has to fill 24 hours with information, whether it makes sense or is useful or not. It used to be news happened, and then somebody reported on news happening. Now everything becomes news at some level, depending on how bad they need to fill the 24 hour cycle. So it's...
I mean, it's I feel like Desert Storm was the first war you could adjust fire by watching TV.
Yes. Yeah. That's frightening. All right, next slide. All right, do that. And we're right almost on time. We, Addie, do you know what the
what time's the next session? 8 or
9:30?
Anybody got a calendar
for him? I do. I'm
just curious.
9:30. Does anybody else have dreams you get called back up?
Oh my goodness gracious!
Oh, yes.
I get dreams about not fitting in my uniform.
Yeah.
Oh, that's not a dream. That's a fact.
I'm shaped like I am now, but for some strange reason, I'm a two-striper again, and I can't get the. I'm balding and bearded and fat.
In my case, if I had that dream, it's like, you're going to let me fly again? Yeah, let's go do this. I would be really excited.
Am I the only one that's naked in that dream?
Okay, now the rest of you need something sharp to go back in my time. All right, everybody, take a break. Grab coffee if you can find it. You're going to have to go downstairs to the restaurant.
We just got a coffee urine.
Okay.
So we're working on it.
All right, thank you.